Let's stand this beautiful Sunday morning, Pentecost Sunday. It's so good to be in the house of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God's so good. I'd like to welcome all our guests this morning. But more than anything, I would like to welcome the King of Kings. He's already here. Hallelujah. Whatever you need, he's already here. Let's give him some praise this morning. Let's magnify him. Let's exalt the church. Come on. We are in the presence of the King of Glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Presence with thanksgiving in your heart and giving praise. Give him praise. Jesus.
this morning. Hallelujah, God, you're worthy. Hallelujah. I know you've been standing already quite some long time this morning, but I'd like you to turn with me this morning to the Acts chapter 2. We're going to start at 1. And I'll read down to verse 6. So Acts chapter 2. If you're there, say amen. It says, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of a fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And they were all dwelling in Jerusalem, Jews, devout men out of every nation under heaven. Now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded because that every man heard them speak in his own language. And then we'll go over to Acts chapter 2, verse 37 and 38. 39. It says, now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are far off, as many as the Lord our God shall call. Hallelujah. I want to preach to you this morning about the uncontainable power of the Holy Ghost. Jesus, Lord God, I praise you and I thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. I thank you, Lord God, for what you already have done this morning, God, and what you're about to do, Lord. And I pray, God, that they would not see me, God, but that they would see you, Lord God. I pray and ask you for your anointing, God. Anoint our ears, Lord God. Do a work in Jesus, Lord, in our midst, Lord God. In Jesus' name, pour out your spirit, Lord God, like you did on the day of Pentecost, Lord. In Jesus' name. Church said amen. And God bless you. You may be seated. I'll try not to be lengthy. But like I said, I don't want to hinder what God is already doing in this house. I believe God's got a great work. And, you know, I'm like, this is the birth of the church. It's not confounded to just the book of Acts. But we are living what they taught, what they preached, what they felt. We are living it today, almost 2,000 years ago, and we're still, the Holy Ghost is still being poured out. Amen. And as I was reading it and I was studying it, it's amazing that that with all this stuff and everything, is even when I was writing out my message, it's like, God, I can't contain this all in one message. And I was thinking, it's uncontainable. 2,000 years ago, how can you contain something that God did 2,000 years ago and he's still doing it today? God's not done pouring out his spirit. If you have never been filled with the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues, today is your day. You cannot contain his spirit. Nor his power or his word. John 21, verse 25, and says, and there are also many other things which Jesus did, the which, if they could be written, every one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that should be written. If I ran around this building this morning, and I called on each and every person to testify, we would be here all day of hearing the goodness of God. God has done for you. What he's brought you out, what he saved you from, what he delivered you from. The deliverer is in the house. The King of Glory is in this place. The one thing that gets me is that they tarried. They waited for the promise. You know, some believe, I believe it's in Corinthians 15, that there was 500 that was there before Jesus ascended. But then when you get to the upper room, only 120 showed up. So if you think about it, there's some that missed out on a blessing. Because they didn't tarry and they didn't wait and they didn't wait around for what God had for them. They took off and they missed what God was doing. There is a couple components I want to bring out. Is first is that you need to obey what God commands you to do. The Bible says that not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together as the manner of some is. See, there's some that are going to forsake the assembly of ourselves together. There's some that are going to say, hey, you know what? Hey, I'm going to just hold off. I'm going to go do my own thing. There are some that are going to do that, but you have obeyed the commandment of the Lord that, hey, you know what? I'm not going to forsake going into the house of the Lord. You've already reached step one in the process. You showed up. As some are going to do what they're going to do. You don't worry about what the crowd is going to do. That 120 wasn't worried about what everybody else was doing. They were having a prayer meeting in that upper room. They were like, hey, I want that promise. God said it. Hey, I'm going to receive it. I know it's coming. God has a promise for you this morning. He gave them a promise, and guess what? That promise is still keep on giving. That promise is still being poured out today. That promise isn't stopped in the last days. Saith the Lord, I will pour out my spirit. He's still pouring out his spirit. Amen. On what? On all flesh. It cannot be contained in just an upper room. It can't be contained in just between four walls. His power is uncontainable. It's overwhelming. What led you here this morning wasn't your own ability and wasn't your own strength. It was the power of God moving on you, driving you to the house of the Lord. You think you came up in your own mind, hey, I'm going to just be in the house of God? You think that originated from you? No, God planted that seed and said, hey, you know what? You need to be in the house of the Lord. And something said, hey, you know what? That sounds like a good idea. I'm going to go to the house of the Lord. Whether that's from somebody that's telling you about Jesus, whatever it is, somebody is here that needs the Holy Ghost. Hey, I have the Holy Ghost, but I'll take seconds. I'll take a renewing every chance I can get. Even the books could not contain of all that he has done. Think about it. All that Jesus has done, it could not even be contained in the Word of God. The Word couldn't even contain it. Hallelujah. I suppose is that we'd probably be here all day if we were testifying. Maybe we do a dance. Maybe we do a bunch of hand clapping, shouting, rejoicing. Can I go a little bit further this morning? You cannot contain his mercy. Why? Because it endureth forever. It doesn't stop giving. His mercy doesn't stop being poured out. We don't deserve the Holy Ghost. I don't want to break anybody's heart here this morning. We do not deserve the Holy Ghost. It's out of God's mercy and his kindness and his grace that he even poured out his spirit on us. We are recipients of something so much greater than ourselves. It cannot be just contained in a vessel. Though we do have a treasure in an earthly vessel. It was always meant to be poured out. It was never meant to be confined and confined into just an individual, and just to a local body of believers. They didn't know what was going to transpire. They knew that there was going to be a promise. They knew that, hey, you know what? God's going to pour out his spirit. They didn't know what was going to transpire in the moments ahead. But all they knew is, hey, you know what? Let's pray. Let's ask God. Let's believe God for the promise. The Bible says in Acts chapter 1, verse 4, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized you with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Hallelujah. And about verse 8 says, but ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Jesus already said, hey, my spirit cannot just be contained in an upper room. It cannot just be contained in Jerusalem or in Judea or in Samaria, but it's got to spread into all the uttermost part of the earth. Amen. You leave this place this morning, it cannot just be contained just in you. It is meant to be poured out into somebody else. You are meant to be and called to be witnesses of his goodness, of his mercy, of his grace, of his power. You know, if you really got the Holy, you know how you got, you got somebody got the Holy Ghost? When you got a new convert and they get the Holy Ghost, there's something that happens. They tell everybody. They don't keep it inside. They don't bottle it up because it's just overwhelming. It's, I got to tell somebody, hey, I got the Holy Ghost. You need the Holy Ghost too. Man, you're crazy. Get away from me. That is what God wants. He wants it bubbling up in us. He wants it. He said, hey, God, I don't want it just contained in you. I want it pouring out of you. You can't contain his forgiveness. It doesn't matter what you did here this morning, how many times you failed and failed and repeatedly fail, God's still reaching out and still wants to forgive. God's reaching for somebody, I believe, here this morning. You can't contain his forgiveness. It's uncontainable. It's free to everybody. You know, when he would heal somebody and he would touch somebody, I think about the woman caught in the middle of adultery. And you know what he said to him when all her accusers had left? He said, go and sin no more. He wasn't condemning her. He forgave her and said, hey, you've been forgiven. Now you go and sin no more. See, we would like to just hold those stones and condemn those that have messed up and everything else. And there is a whole prison cell full of them. But God's forgiveness is for them as well. It's for each and every person in this place. It's for every person that is in this city, in this nation, in this world. I don't care how far you think you've got. God will forgive you and can forgive you. It's a lie from the enemy. Says that you've gone too far and you messed up too much. This was the last shot. It's done now. You're written off. That's not how God works. You can't contain his forgiveness. Just like you can't contain his power. It's ever reaching. You can't contain his love because it's unconditional. Meaning there is no strings attached. There's no strings attached with God's love. This was a gift. It wasn't, hey, you had to do something for it. It was a gift that was being poured out. While we were yet sinners, he died for us. You didn't earn it, but he gave it anyway. You were in darkness, and he still reached for you. He still loved you. See, your love is conditional. When we talk about love, we say, hey, I need my love reciprocated. Hey, I need what you're offering. If I do this for you, please do this for me. You do X, Y, Z, and we can work something out. We can make a deal. You scratch my back and I'll scratch yours. God knows this about us. Why? Because he created us and he is God. And here's honestly, we're not God. That's why when he says, if you love me, keep my commandments. He wants our love. His love is freely given, but he knows that in order for us to love him back, we have to do something. We have to give him all that we have. God's love cannot be contained. God's friendship cannot be contained. Jesus is a friend of tax collectors and sinners. And those Pharisees and everything else rebuked Jesus and said, man, this guy sits with sinners and publicans. He befriended those that were not a friend to society, that nobody wanted to deal with, because it would damage their image and damage how they look. You know, we need to be sitting down with sinners and those that have messed up in life. And you know what? There might be some religious folk that come by and say, I can't believe he's sitting with that person. I can't believe he's doing that with that person. Man, I'm like, something must be going on there. You know how our way of thinking can be so messed up? We can so look at some situation and say, man, there's got to be something going on there, when all Jesus is doing is trying to minister, and God is trying to minister here this morning. His friendship extends to everybody, even those that would reject him. You know, the church should have the same accusation against it, that we should be friends of sinners. Hey, I'm the chiefest of sinners. I still need God's forgiveness. I still need God's mercy. I have not arrived at all. Hallelujah. You can't contain God's love and his friendship. He said in John 15 and 14, you are my friends if you do whatsoever I command you. Part of it is obeying God. He'll extend his friendship just like he did with the rich young ruler. But he said, hey, if you're going to be my friend back, I'm going to need something from you. I need you to give up everything and forsake all and follow me. That means giving up your own life, the old things that have attached itself to you. He wants you to give it all up. Why? Because it's been damaging you, because it's been destroying you, because it's been wrecking you. And God is trying to save you from that life. God is trying to restore you. He's trying to make a purpose out of your life. He's trying to make a reason for your life. That it's not wrapped up in this world. It's not wrapped up in the things of this world. It's not wrapped up into relationships, but it's wrapped up in the Lord and Savior. I'm going to tell you, when you find Jesus, it makes every relationship that you have worthwhile. When you find Jesus, it makes everything that you do worthwhile. Doesn't mean you're not going to go through hard times, but it's worth it all. You start finding a purpose and a reason why I can go another day, why I can get up each and every morning. He makes a way out of no way. God made a way for us to be saved. You cannot do it without doing it his way. I said all this to say this: we cannot do it without him. Acts 17 and 28 says, for in him we live and move and have our being. We cannot do it in our own abilities. We can't do it in our own creativity and everything that we can conjure up and everything that we can pull out of ourselves and our abilities, our gifts, our talents. We can't do it without him. anointing that breaks the yoke. I'm not worried if you can't sing. I'm not worried if you can't preach. I'm not worried if you can't do this. I'm wondering, is there anointing on your life? Because if there's anointing on your life, there's going to be some bonds that are broken. There's going to be people that are set free. There's going to be deliverance that happens. Those gifts and talents that God has given you, whatever it is. You know, I wish I had a car mechanic in my family. You know, that's the talent I don't want. But if God's given it, give that gift to God. That belongs to him. You didn't earn it. God gave it to you. God gave you the mental capacity and the ability to work on vehicles. You know, when Brother Smith was here and he was talking about the gift of helps, and I'm still rolling over that message. And I look at this body of believers. And I see, and you know, there's a lot of people that go under behind the scenes that don't even get noticed. There's a lot of help that is in this church. And I want to say that even though that you might not be recognized, and you probably don't want to be recognized, God sees it. And God knows what you're doing behind the scenes. See, here's the thing. It's not about us. It's not how we look. It's not about who's standing behind the pulpit. It's not who's behind the keyboard. It's not who's all that in a bag of chips. It's all about him. It's always been about him. Because our abilities, they can only take us so far. These disciples, they walked with Jesus. They spent time with Jesus. And they still messed up time and time again. And you would think, man, when are they going to learn? 3 years with Jesus. You would think, you know, you have God manifest in the flesh with you. How? I'm like, you can't get it right now? I'm like, Peter, you're still being called a devil? You're denying Christ? And you see all that, but yet at the same time, you see the uncontainable mercies of God. And the uncontainable love of God. But Jesus knew there was a day that was going to fully come, that his spirit was going to be poured out. And he said, you know what? You try to do it on your own abilities, you can't. I'm going to send a comforter. I'm going to send help. I'm going to send a refreshing. We can't do it on our own. We need God's help. We need his aid. And let me just tell you, God's not going to do it for you either. God is a gentleman. He does not force you. He does not push you down the line and say, hey, you go. It's your turn. That's not how God operates. The Bible says, who the Son sets free is free indeed. If you have been born again of the water and spirit this morning, let me help somebody out here this morning. You have been set free. If you have been bound and you're still struggling with things, nobody's here is judging you and nobody's condemning you. But I want to tell you in the Holy Ghost that you have victory. That you are not bound this morning. You have been set free. The issue is that you need to walk in it. That is the issue, is that you need to take a step and walk in that authority that God has already given you. You have power when you receive the Holy Ghost. You have been endued with power from on high. Who the Son sets free is free indeed. You take that liberty that God has given you and you walk in it. The problem is when people are filled with the Spirit and the time goes on and on, the Spirit starts to being quenched. It starts to be dulled a little bit. It starts to lose its effectiveness and its wear. And it's not God that's doing it. It's not God that's hindering it. It's not the devil either. If you're going that direction, I'm gonna stop you there. It's not the devil either. We like to blame everything on Satan. And he does play a factor in it. He does help aid little temptation that you have. He makes it a little bit more accessible for you. But at the same time, when it comes down to you, you've got power to tread on serpents this morning. I don't just want to go back to the day of Pentecost and just revisit. I want to live it day in and day out, every single day of my life. And I know, hallelujah, that guess what? I'm going to be walking in the power on Monday, and I'm going to be walking on the power on Tuesday. I'm going to be walking in the Spirit on Wednesday, and on Thursday, and Friday, and Saturday. And when I come back on Sunday, I'm ready to go. I'm primed. I'm ready to shout the victory. We cannot overcome sin on our own. What are you talking about, Lukky? I'm talking about you need his power. You need the Holy Ghost. You've been trying to do it on your own for so long. You've been trying to do it with your own abilities for so long. It's not working. You're struggling. And God says, I'm going to come along and I'm going to help you. I'm going to guide you. God sent this nobody to tell you God loves you this morning. And God has a place prepared for you. I'm nothing without the grace and mercy of God. What he started in that upper room could not be contained there. It couldn't be confined in that space. And this morning, if you've got the Holy Ghost, it just can't contain there. Have you ever felt God in the hot service and you just gotta shout and you gotta dance and you just gotta move your body? Hey, see, that's the Holy Ghost, because it can't be contained in that space. It says, I gotta get out, I gotta do something. I got a message to share. When you're on your job and your bosses might, and your job might try to confine you and say, hey, you can't share that here. God's bigger than that. He's bigger than that. And I'll tell you why. Because the Bible says you have power to become witnesses. You just walk in it. People always get this sense, there's something different about that brother. There's something different about that sister. There's something, I'm like, I just can't put my hand on it. They don't curse. I'm like, they're always well kept. They're always working hard. They're always helping somebody out. They're always loving somebody. They're always encouraging. They're always building up. That is the fruit and the byproduct of the fruit of the Spirit. That is not you and me. I cannot do that on my own. That is the power of the Holy Ghost. That is his Spirit working in you and through you to show people and to reveal to you that there's something different. And it takes a people getting a hold of it. The reason why the early church was able to turn their world upside down and flip it upside down and right side up and however, whichever way, it seems like you're on a roller coaster when you think about it. Of all the stuff they go through, after one hindrance, after another hindrance, and they're just busting through. Let's have revival. Nothing was hindering it. Nothing was containing it. Nothing was confining it. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees, they're like, what is going on here? Why can't we stop this? Why can't we hinder this? Why can't we mold this and shape this the way we want to? Because it's not an idol. It's not an idol. It's not something that was formed by man's hands. But it is the power of the Holy Ghost. And we try to manipulate it. And we try to twist scripture. Churches do it all the time. We try to say something it doesn't say, just so somebody can follow along with us. Hey, there's doctrines of devils in the world, folks. I don't know if you know this, but there is doctrines of devils that are trying to steal people from the church of God. I'm not going to name the churches, Because the Holy Ghost will already, the Spirit will already lead you to truth. It'll already reveal to you what's false and what's real. If you're walking in the Holy Ghost, you're going to know what's real. You're going to be able to say, hey, you know what? That's not right. That doesn't ring right. That doesn't ring right in my spirit. There's something off about it. There's something just not right about it. There's something that just doesn't sit well. It's just got that little, And have you ever got that, Maybe it's a hunger pain this morning. I don't know. But I've got the, and then I'm like, yeah, there's that just doesn't have a ring to it. There's something off about it. That's not you. That's the Holy Ghost. That's the power of God working in you and through you. There's a reason why you walk in the Spirit and not after the flesh. I'll tell you what, you're going to miss out on things. And this is the one thing God was revealing to me when I was worshiping and when you guys were praising. I'm like, and the power of God was in this place and the power of God is still in this place. But God was revealing something to me. He's saying, if you didn't have a walk with me, would you even experience any of this? Or would you be dull and numb to it? And you wouldn't even be able to recognize my presence and my peace and my power. Would you even have any opportunity to witness somebody? You're going to be missing out on opportunities to witness to somebody. I'm going to tell you in the Holy Ghost, if you do not walk in the Spirit and you determine to say, hey, you know what? I'm just going to live half-heartedly. You are going to miss out on opportunities that God has for you to be a witness and to be his vessel to be used in the kingdom of God. If you wake up in the morning and you say, I know it might be hard. I'll tell you what. Peter, when he preached the Acts 2:38 message, he didn't sugarcoat it. I'm not here to sugarcoat anything for anybody. I'm here to preach the truth in love, though. If you have the Holy Ghost, I pray that there's conviction in this house. Because we need revival. If you have the Holy Ghost, there is doors opening up every single day for you to be a blessing and you to be used in the kingdom of God. And when you quench that spirit, all you're doing is hindering the move of God, not just in your life, but in somebody else's life. It's bigger than just me and you. It's bigger than just us. It's about him, and we are designed to be, we're made by him and for him. You cannot serve two masters. You are literally going to leave the house of God and do one or two things. You are going to seek the face of God, or are you going to go back to doing what you normally do? These disciples, these 120 in upper room, it was more than just the disciples. It was Mary, there was the women, and everything else there. They did not just stay in that condition. They just didn't feel with the Holy Ghost. Well, hey, you know, we got the Holy Ghost. That was great, awesome. Hey, shake your hands. That was a good prayer meeting. Hey, see you later. I'm gonna go back to fishing. See you guys. Hey, Matthew, what are you going to do? I think I'm going to go tax collecting. That sounds good. I was making lots of money back then. I don't know why I got a squeaky voice there. But, I tell my son, Mike, I'm ready for church. I'm getting hyped. And he's like, Dad, you're cringe. You're cringe worthy. And I don't know if young people use hype anymore, but I like the word. I say, you know, I'm hyped about going to church. I'm hyped about what I feel in the house of God. Hallelujah. God is good. We need his spirit. Don't quench the spirit of God, church. When you wake up in the morning and you feel that inclination, hey, you know what, I don't need to pray, ignore that voice. That voice is trying to hinder your walk with God. That voice is trying to tell you stop walking in the power. You don't need that. And then day in and day out, you struggle with the same thing that you struggle with. I'm telling you here in the Holy Ghost, he wants to set you free. He just doesn't want to fill people with the Holy Ghost, but he wants to set you free this morning. What time is it? 11:17. Let's stand this morning. I'm not done. the Holy Ghost is not done. I might be done. I might be done with my message. I don't want to preach and wear you guys out and cause you guys to fall asleep and everything else. But I want you to know that the Holy Ghost is here this morning. Now, there's only one question that has ever, if Sister Nellie, you would come. If there's only one question that has been asked in the Bible, you will not find it anywhere else. And if you do, please tell me. But I guarantee you will not find it anywhere else. There's one question that has says, now, when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart, and they said unto Peter and to the rest of the brethren, men and brethren, what shall we do? They asked him, hey, how am I able to be saved? I heard the gospel. I heard the death, burial, and resurrection. I'm ready to change. I'm ready for there to be a shift. God wants a personal Pentecost in our lives. That's only the one question. And when people say, hey, well, what do I need to be saved? It's right there. You just point them to Acts 2, verse 37. What should I do? He said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall. He didn't say you might, maybe. I don't know. You kind of look like somebody that might not. No, you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. God wants to pour out his spirit here. Hallelujah. For the promise, and I'm telling you this, uncontainable. For the promise is unto you, but it just doesn't extend just to you. It's not just for you. That's why you need to walk in the power of his spirit. And to your children. Hey, it's for your children. I don't care how old your children are. They could be 60, they could be 40, they could be 20, they could be 8, they could be 5, they can be our age. It's to your children. That promise is just, it extends. It's uncontainable. It extends to generation to generation. But it doesn't stop there. And it says, into all that are far off. It doesn't stop there. It's uncontainable. His Holy Ghost is being poured out. You know, I look at those at the Asbury revival, and there's people that are critics that have come alongside and criticized it, and that's fine. You could criticize it and everything else. I'm like, you have that right to criticize things, but I'll tell you what it revealed to me, that there is a hunger in the earth. There is a cry that is calling out. What shall I do? What do I need? What do I need? You need to repent. You can't get around, and you need to tell God you're sorry. And you need to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. That is a washing away your sins. You got a new slate. You're clean. But it doesn't stop there. You need to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. I invite you to come this morning.